Hello, my name is Ben Slavic, and I've spent my life studying how people acquire languages. Almost a half a century of it, 24/7. And I have concluded that people acquire languages through comprehensible input. So I'm going to be doing a whole bunch of podcasts around it, because I've written a lot of books about comprehensible input. But who has time to read anymore, right? So, especially some of you teachers, I bow down, gaosho, I think is the Japanese term, is to bow down to you. Some teachers have 8 classes. A teacher in Oklahoma told me that she herself only has 7 classes to teach. Some of her colleagues have 8. So with what's happening in education right now, with all the new changes brought about by COVID, online teaching, our new awareness of, well, the racial piece, the equity piece, the inclusion piece, the post-George Floyd era piece, which is, to me, personally, if you'll allow me an editorial comment, the most important part. So what we want to do is come up with curriculums that allow us to teach on a level playing field. Now that's going to be about 20 or 30 podcasts down the road. I'm going to limit these podcasts to 30 minutes. Otherwise, I'd do a 4-hour podcast. But I'm doing these podcasts because one of the reasons is people don't have time to even read anymore. So kind of shifting from writing books to doing podcasts about comprehensible input. So let's start. You know, in my Big CI book, I wrote a book called The Big CI Book, put out by Teachers Discovery. You know, there's, let me find out where I am here. Okay, that book was written in 2014. And I put an article in there that I found out years and years ago that I found on the internet from somebody in France. And if you want to reference this more deeply, please shoot me an email. I'll send you the link. But honestly, the idea of the standard in our field of communication to me is very, very similar, if not identical, to the concept of what conversation is. Isn't that what we really want? Isn't that what our... Now, I'm assuming my audience here is people who have heard about, studied a little bit, or a lot, about comprehensible input and want to know how, not just how it works, but how to put it in practice in their classroom. I assume this is our foundational point of agreement, I hope. It's a platform from which we can launch all these podcasts. The podcast we're going to do today and probably for quite some time will be talking about how people acquire languages in general and the general nature of what comprehensible input is. The so-called comprehensible input revolution, and it is a revolution. It's a shift. It's a paradigm shift. It is not something that's going to go away. So what I want to do in this podcast is, and many of them coming up, is to talk generally about comprehensible input. But as we get deeper into it down the road, I will tell you and share with you in my own experience with ways that are successful in bringing comprehensible input successfully into your classroom. Did I say to make it successful instead of... That must be a horrible feeling to be teaching and then you know you're 20 years into your career and all of a sudden somebody says comprehensible input and then you're going to go like, well, this is not an easy thing to do, to shift away from doing, you know, what you were doing. And I'm not saying that you have to shift over to you may be in a building that's going to allow you to teach in a way that you always have. I would appeal rather to the kind of a core feeling in you that it just doesn't feel right. It I want to talk to teachers in these podcasts about, who just don't feel like it's working for them in the classroom. And they've heard vaguely about comprehensible input, but they don't know quite what it is, and they're seeking more information. And that's what these podcasts are going to be about. They're going to go from general talk about CI, comprehensible input, to specific talk about how to make it work in your classroom. But this passage that I wanted to talk about in our first podcast here first appeared in the Big CI book in 2014. But I'm going to repeat it here because it's so critically important for language teachers to know what their real goal in class should be. And that is, according to my own thinking, simple conversation with our students in the target language, as opposed to teaching the language. Let that sink in. Because the standard is communication, and when I hear the word communication, I hear conversation. To me, it's the same. So let's talk about communication slash conversation. Because you can't teach a language. Your goal should be to share pleasant conversation with your students. And if you've studied CI, you know that all that is needed is that. Because language acquisition is an unconscious process that results from massive modern languages. The research is around 10,000 hours of comprehensible input, of input. And if you're a Chinese teacher or some other non-modern language teacher, you're in for 24,000 hours that are required. Now stop and think about that in terms of the amount of time you have in a four-year program. It's a fraction. I have figured out that if you teach a four-year program and speak using comprehensible input in the target language, obviously, to your students for every minute of those 4 years, you're still only going to have 1/20th of the time that you need to reach your kids. So if you're burning out trying to get kids ready for the AP exam, don't burn out. I've had my experiences with teacher burnout, getting them ready for competitions, getting them ready for national tests, getting them ready for common assessments that happen every 6 or 7 weeks in your school, getting them ready for the test, getting them ready for the end of the year. Look. Oh man, I really share this from my heart. Let's not burn out. Let's not burn out like trying to, well, what are we trying to do? Look, I did the traditional thing for 25 years. I was an AP language and literature, French literature teacher back when they had the AP literature exam. I used to just burn myself out. I used to be shaking. I my health was in danger like in early May after the AP exam. And I only had a few students in those AP classes, you know what I mean? We lose them along the way. We start out with 35, we end up with 2. Okay, kind of on a roll here, but I want to get back to the concept of what our goals are as we begin our podcasts about comprehensible input. So far I've said that you can't really teach a language, you can only share pleasant conversation with your students. This is not what happens in other classes. So we are a different breed here. And we need to address we need to design curriculums that are built around what's best for the students, not what's best for the testing industry, not what's best for the textbook industry. The irony of the whole thing is that when you just share pleasant conversation with your students as opposed to teaching them the language, is that immense gains in proficiency are happen as a result of the judicious use of instructional minutes dedicated to comprehensible input in the form of listening and reading. So this, here's this article. I'm going to read the first passage is from this article. It's this. Conversation differs from other forms of interaction, interview, debate. Hang on a second. I'm going to check. I'm not sure the video's on. Yes, it's on. Thank you. Sorry. I was just thinking, I was talking into that camera and into this podcast format without having the camera be on. Okay, so listen. This is the first passage that I want to read. Conversation differs from other forms of interaction, and it gives the examples of interview, debate, symposium, negotiation, and consultation. By its familiar, improvised, and free nature, nothing that makes up conversation is decided in advance, and it has no other permanence than its own practice. It is divorced from any planned outcome. Its principal motivating force is pleasure. Boy, that sounds... I don't think that's from Noam Chomsky, but it sure sounds like him. You know, the idea that you just... It's so relieving to it. It's such an immense feeling of relief to a teacher to know that all they have to do, they don't have to plan, they don't have to really test very much. I'll be talking extensively about testing, specifically how to do that later. But isn't it just a great feeling to know that really, and this is my opinion based on my own experience, I have to say that, all we really have to do to get these massive gains, huge gains, and I've experienced it myself because I taught traditionally for 25 years and I taught using comprehensible input for about 21 years now. So that's a lot of years. And I've come to the conclusion, you know, hey, Ben, what did you learn in half a century of teaching? Well, I learned one thing, that it doesn't have to be painful, that I don't have to tear my hair out. I don't have to set my hair on fire. I don't have to teach like a pirate, if that's a reference that you may or may not get. I don't have to go crazy, okay? I don't have to go crazy. I don't have to wake up at night worrying about some parent who's on my case because I'm not teaching the way she thinks I should, or he thinks I should. I can just enjoy my job, go home at night, spend time with my loved ones, and not worry so much about all this stuff. It's just a job, y'all. Oh my God. But let me go on. The principal motivating force of conversation is pleasure. The kids come in, they sit down, they know they're going to have a good time. They know they're going to have a good time. It may be their only time during the day when they're not stuck in the left hemisphere of their brain. I'll go into this much later. But wouldn't that just be a plus right there? It makes our jobs easy for us, and it makes the students' jobs of being students easy for them. And yet they get a lot of more gains. I really want to say that again. My experience... Again, there may be other people who think about comprehensible input differently, but my own personal experience is that I have gotten so much more relaxed, so much less stressed. I sleep better. I don't worry about my job so much, and I certainly don't plan hardly at all versus the way I felt, you know, before I heard about comprehensible input in 2001. So, isn't that just, it's a freeing thought, because tagged with that is that our students, ironically, you would think, well, he's working so much less, but his students are gaining so much more in proficiency. if you've studied comprehensible input at all, you know what I just said. You know what I mean. Let's look at another passage from this article called The Art of Conversation. This is my translation, by the way, from the French. Conversation is made up of a linguistic tissue. I have to stop there. This paragraph has about, 30, 40 words in it. But I've got to stop there. Conversation is made up of a linguistic tissue. Wow. What linguistic tissue? Well, it's the language. The kids come in, they sit down. They have pleasant looks on their face because they're having such great success, all of them, because of the way you're teaching them using comprehensible input. And so if the language is the linguistic tissue that makes up conversation or / communication, same thing to me. If the linguistic tissue is made up of a language, then what is the vehicle to deliver the language? And that's comprehensible input. So that's a good definition, isn't it? I mean, there are many definitions. You can go online and look up the definitions. But for me, communication and conversation are made up of a linguistic tissue, which is the language which ties people together in a kind of web of connectedness. That's my definition. Okay, so I'll finish that paragraph. Conversation is made up of a linguistic tissue thanks to which the members of a community not only communicate on a daily basis. Now think about your own classroom there. I think about my classroom going back, decades. It wasn't always that. It wasn't always... It didn't always contain a linguistic tissue thanks to which the members of a community not only communicate on a daily basis, but also guarantee their membership in the group. Oh boy, I think we just hit on the equity inclusion piece. Because ever since George Floyd got murdered, we kind of need to address that in our instruction. I have been contacted, parenthetically, I'll just throw this out on sidebar real quick. I've been contacted by two schools who in their district are having to launch, and they're very serious about it, as soon as possible, symposiums, workshops on Zoom internationally with language teachers to figure out a way to address racism and the inclusion piece. You will find out if you stay with me on these podcasts. You will find out that it's doable, and I've designed already. I'm completely done with designing an entire curriculum that allows you to teach not just online but to address the equity piece. It's the work of my life. It's far better than any books I've written in the past, like the Big CI book. Or I wrote a book in 2016 called The Invisibles, based on the experience that I had in India teaching at the American Embassy School in New Delhi after retired from the Denver Public Schools. That book, The Invisibles, has been, I think it got out there, but Teachers Discovery didn't want to publish it because it was 550 pages. They said, take your book on the invisibles and split it into two, and we will publish that book. I didn't want to at first, but I realized I had to. Because anytime you have developed a curriculum that addresses equity, that addresses teaching online, I didn't want to do it, quite frankly. I was burned out on writing books. But The Invisibles, 2016, I should say, those of you, because some of you guys know my books, I would say, forget TPRS in a year, PQA in a wink, and even that little gem of a book I wrote in 2012 called Stepping Stones to Stories. I would like to point to the following books that you may or may not be familiar with. 2014 Big CI book, 2016 The Invisibles. Oh, there's one just before the Big CI book. There's a book called A Natural Approach to Stories. And then these other two books that I wrote, you know, to take the big fat Invisibles, 550 pages, and put it into two. I'll talk about those books later, but the three books I just mentioned are yours for free. Email me at benslavic.com and you get them. Those are cool books. Big CI book, A Natural Approach to Stories, which is the basis for the curriculum I just described that addresses racism and addresses teaching online quite well. And I have about 150 testimonials from teachers I've been working with lately who shifted everything in favor of changing over to this new way. This new curriculum I've developed. I'm kind of rambling here. I hope it makes sense. If you're new, don't worry about it. But yeah, free books. Say, hey, Ben, send me my free books, and it'll be, let's see, Big CI book, Natural Approach to Stories, Stepping Stones to Stories, and that's it. You get three free books just for listening. Now, if you're still with me, because not all language teachers want to teach this way, and this is just my own experience based on my own propensities, my own natural inclinations as a teacher. You know, I always felt when I was teaching, why can't I reach these kids more? So I kept trying, and I feel like I've done it. I really feel like I've done it, y'all. Can you hear it in my voice? It's just there. It's just like, okay, I now have a curriculum that works online, addresses the racism piece, and comes out with massive amounts of higher proficiency gains than I used to. Okay. That was the first paragraph. Here's the second paragraph from this article that is even better. Again, this is my translation. Ready? See how much time we got left. I want to make sure we stay in under the time. Okay. So, here it is. Conversation is made up of a linguistic tissue, thanks to which the members of a community not only communicate on a daily basis, but also guarantee their membership in the group. I think I stopped there. Let's go on. Next, one more sentence. Through conversation, the individual constructs his social place in the group. Okay. So the passage, especially the second one that I just read, say this, it's kind of, let's recap what we just said. Conversation has a familiar nature, that is, people who converse are familiar with one another. Conversation is improvised. That means it's not forced. We make it up as it goes along. Now, let's just stop here, and let's get honest for a second. Many teachers will say, I can't make up a conversation as it goes along because it won't teach the words that are on the list that I have to teach to keep my job. First of all, you can teach any way you want and keep your job because they don't have any language teachers anymore. So don't be so afraid of losing your job if you don't teach the word lists. Also, this is a misconception, I think, out there on the internet about my work. A lot of people think, well, he just says, just wing it and start talking and whatever. But I have a job. I have to teach to the common assessment because all the students and all the teachers, we all be on the same page and all that. I'm not saying not do that, okay? I want to underline that. I will say it again. I'm not saying not to teach so that you're afraid of losing your job because you're not teaching the word lists out of the textbook or following the same curriculum that all the other teachers are following in your department or across the district. I'm not saying that at all. I'm saying, why don't you stay with me, stay with these podcasts, learn how to do comprehensible input, And then do 1 or 2 minutes of comprehensible input at the end of class. And then maybe it'll grow to 4 or 5 minutes. And maybe it'll grow to 10 minutes so that at the end of class, you're using comprehensible input for 10 minutes of class, but first you're teaching everything else you need to teach 35 minutes. That's fine. Yeah, absolutely. So the purpose of these podcasts really is to help the teacher who wants to know about comprehensible input, doesn't necessarily want to, you know, leave what they're doing with the traditional stuff, and there's nothing wrong with it. Just keep doing it. And so now you'll have another thing to do. And I think your kid's going to like it a lot better. But let's just leave that alone. So that we were talking about what we derived from the passage about conversation above. Like, I think we are now here to say the conversation is free. We learned that from the passage. To me, that means it's not limited in scope to any predetermined idea. I just said that. So let's go to our fourth idea about what conversation is. Conversation has pleasure as its goal. Now, what does that mean? We enjoy the conversation first and foremost, is what it means to me. We enjoy the conversation in class first and foremost. Stephen Krashen has said that the path of pleasure is the only path. The path of pain does not work for language acquisition. That's quite a statement. Because how many of our students are in pain right now? Either because they're being excluded, for whatever reason, they're different, you know. Maybe they have the wrong skin color. Maybe they come from a family that has no books in the home. Maybe they are not going to college. Again, let's have a gut check, honest moment. Is it not true that you've been favoring the few, the 5 or 6 kids that are college bound, usually white? If that's not true, fine, I'd say, shut up, Ben. But if there's any truth to the fact that you've been favoring the few, let's keep talking. And then there's that beautiful part that says, our communication in class with our students should feel that it's made up of this unpolluted, that's my word, unpolluted linguistic tissue. Just a pure language, not polluted with English. So let's stop mixing English with the target language. If you want to speak English, you can speak English 45 minutes for all I care in your class. Explain whatever you want. But do try to find 5 or 6 or 10 minutes, you know, for uninterrupted, unpolluted linguistic tissue, language, CI, whatever language you teach. And then that last part, we can't talk about this stuff enough because it is our very foundation. We can't build a house that's going to stay up unless it has a really strong foundation. And this is foundational discussion right here. I'm going to stop in a minute. But the last one is that we should guarantee our students' place in a community. Okay. So many ramifications of that. I'm going to stop here. This is our first podcast ending. I do have a Patreon site on which there is quite a bit of other information. If you want to go over there, check it out. It's there. In the meantime, these podcasts and all my blogs going back to 2007 will be available to you at no cost. The Patreon is one, you know how Patreon works, a monthly membership with different tiers and things. But anyway, I hope you enjoyed this first podcast. If it spoke to you at any level, see you again for podcast 2, and we'll continue talking about the art of conversation. Thank you very much. Now stop that video as well, if I can get up. I rode 62 miles yesterday. Jeez. I can't even get up. Ow.